Welcome to Rockin' the Planet with Shane, the show dedicated to bringing live New Zealand music to your television screens every single week of the year. And what a year it's been. And tonight is no exception. I've got my very special guests here, the rock and roll all-stars. We've got John, Michael and Chris, but they're ready to roll. We'll talk to them in just a sec. Let's get back to the CT Club where they rocked our socks off last Friday night with Roll Over Beethoven. Beatles classic, Chuck Berry song, and John Loveday in the front there singing lead vocals. John, it's a pleasure to have you here this evening.
How good to see you, Shane.
Yeah. Welcome to the show. Great. At
Thank
last
you.
We got you on the show.
Yes.
And you did play hard to get, folks. But no, it's lovely to have you here. Now, you have done, what, 50 years in the music business
yeah,
since you picked up your first
off,
guitar?
Yeah.
Tell me about it. It was in England, obviously.
In England, I started, yeah, in 1962.
62. Where are you from?
Yorkshire.
They say, go on, tell me. No one knows. They make great pies.
Yeah, they do make great pies. And puddings. I started in 1962, just with a bunch of guys, you know, as you do get together, yeah. One of them, you know. And
Your inspirations just, then were?
My inspirations then were, number one would definitely be Chuck Berry.
Chuck Berry, yeah.
Ray Charles. All that sort of, you know, pre-Beatle.
Just before
era,
the Beatles.
Yeah, just before
they were listening
Beatles.
To the same sort
That's
of music.
Right.
It was about
yeah.
to burst the bubble. Yeah.
Yeah, and we were on one side of the Pennines and they were on the yeah. other. And yeah, and I started off and then I got moved from band to band, you know, and eventually I got headhunted by one band. And I used to play guitar then and they just wanted me to sing.
Yeah.
And then...
But you had a band at one stage called... John's Followers?
John's Followers,
now
yeah.
they
well,
had quite a little bit of success
yeah,
in England.
Well, the band was actually called John's Followers before I joined.
Oh, really? Oh,
yeah.
I thought it was your
no,
band.
No, it wasn't. Everybody thinks that, yeah. but there were three people in the band called John.
So, okay,
and it got very,
very difficult
it got very confusing, yeah. But we did in 66, 67, we played just about everywhere, up from Newcastle down.
Yeah.
down to Birmingham, even a bit further. You
and
know,
you
but we didn't go over that side of the Pennines, which was...
To Liverpool.
You know, we left that to those,
That's
the
it,
other
yeah.
guys. And we got so that we were playing, you know, we were still working, but we were playing like four or five
yeah.
nights a week.
Five
and
nights
then,
a week.
Yeah.
But you travelled in those little vans, you had your
transit
little
van,
transit
the
van.
Transit van,
as
yeah.
the, that was the traditional thing to
That's
do in
right.
those days.
Yeah.
You got a transit van, you packed your gear in.
Yeah.
And you drove for miles
yeah,
and miles,
miles and
then
miles.
Went back to work in the morning.
Yes, right.
Bleary eyed.
Yeah, yeah.
So you did all that sort of
yeah.
thing.
And then, you know, it just got to the stage where we we just had to give up work. And we were managed by an agent.
The same problem. Yes, exactly. I couldn't keep up with my real job.
We were managed by an agency in Sheffield, and he said, "Oh, do you guys fancy going to Switzerland?" And we said, "Yeah, yeah, why not?" So that's where we went. We went to Switzerland, and then we finished the gig there. And some guy says, "Oh, do you want to come down to Milan?" Well, why not?
Yeah.
So we went over the Alps into Milan, and we stayed in Italy for quite a while. We actually recorded there.
And you had a couple of records released, I believe.
Yeah.
And did they get in charts?
No, but pretty hard to get, you know, in those days it was, you know what it's like.
And Italy,
if you want to put your song on, you've got to have their song.
Did you sing in Italian?
Yes, I did.
Oh, you did? So you just learnt it, like, frenetically or whatever they call it.
Yeah, I mean, I can speak a wee bit, but
And did you do it all by road then? You travelled back to Europe, through Europe, to UK on road?
I mean, in those days, you had to get on the Channel ferry, you know, to go over. And it was a nightmare travelling around in those days. You
of
know,
course.
Because every time you went from, not like it is now, where you can just zoom around anywhere.
Yeah.
Every time you got to the border, oh.
Yeah,
group.
Exactly.
All right, everything out, you know, everything out. Search everything, every time you, nightmare.
Yeah, and then load it all back in. They didn't help you load it back in.
No. But we had a great time, and then it all turned to custard.
Yeah. You know, this is when you got back to UK, you decided to go back, and you played for a little while. What did you do?
I gave up.
You gave it away for a while?
Yeah, I gave it away.
You'd had enough. Yeah. I've had
enough of music, but I've had enough of all the other hassles.
All the hassles
that goes with it, you know.
Yeah, it is a hard time unless you're making huge money.
And I didn't start playing again till young Michael here hauled me up on stage one night when I was at a school function, actually, a PTA function. Wasn't it? Yeah.
And, well, that's going to turn into a big story, and I can tell. So I'm just going to go back to the CT Club just for 5 minutes.
Cool.
Because what we just talked about was pretty much the wild side of life. That is what this song is all about. The wild side of life. Certainly knows about that, I'm telling you. He got, didn't you, John? Now, John, you were telling me a little story before I interrupted you.
Yeah.
So rudely. I want to hear that story. You were just going to talk about Michael there.
Well, I was, I've always been a dancer. I've always danced. I actually learned to dance before I could sing.
As in what?
Rock and roll.
Rock and roll dancing.
And anyway, so we're at this function and Michael, somebody told him that I used to sing in a band. So Michael come up to me and he said, "You used to sing in a band." I said, "Yes, I did." He said, "Well, you're singing a couple of songs in the next bracket. What do you want to do?" I said, "That was
it. See how good you are."
And that actually gave me the bug. And it was fantastic. Funny because Chris and Michael were both in that.
You were there that night.
There was a band called The Waiters.
This is when you came over to New Zealand.
Yeah, this would have been, 88, 89.
Mid-80s.
Yeah.
Here in New Zealand?
Yeah.
So you eventually, you came over, obviously you emigrated here.
I came here in 78, yeah.
And decided to settle here, and this is how this happened.
Yep.
You met them and they got you up to sing. And now tell me, did he pass the audition?
Absolutely.
He did?
Yeah, very impressive.
Fantastic.
Somebody given a whisper that he was good.
This guy, he's good. He's from England. Yeah, he's been around. He's worked in Italy. He can sing in Italian.
with Yorkshire
accent. And all that,
Bessame mucho. You know, don't forget the North Country accent.
We'll go a bit of a twang there.
Oh, dear.
But well done. So, and Michael, of course, Michael Bowes here, who plays the bass in the band. Michael, so you're responsible for getting John back into his music here in New Zealand.
Yep.
And he hasn't looked back since.
No, we don't.
And have you been together in a band ever since, or since the 80s?
No, I was with Chris in many different bands. Yeah.
So John worked with you guys just on that night, and he got the bug, and you carried on with your band. What band did you have at the time?
That was the Waiters with Chris. And
the Waiters? They were a well-known band around town.
And we've been in a few other bands since with Chris.
Oh, we've been together now. 40 years.
I used to make, we've done 1,200 jobs together.
1,200 jobs, amazing.
And then 7 years ago, John gave me a ring.
That's it. Your band, The Waiters, that was a fairly successful band, as I remember, in the 80s.
We worked a lot when bands did a lot of work.
You know, I recall you being around, and I think we worked together somewhere.
December 1992, Only Hunger Working
Man. Do you remember when and where?
New Year's Eve.
1992, New Year's Eve. I don't remember being there.
Yeah.
I don't remember being anywhere.
You did St. Paul.
Yeah, I'd have done all the old hits. Yeah, like, it was a floor show. I was the floor show sort of thing.
Yep, that's right.
And I've got a feeling we did stay very late that night. It was a New Year's Eve, obviously. So I was
had 10 past 12.
I was in good spirits. You guys left at 10 past. I left at 4 a.m.
It was after midnight.
So great. Anyway, and so I wouldn't have known when you walked in the door.
No.
Mike.
And I was inspired by these guys, especially this guy.
The Beatles and Paul McCartney.
Seeing yourself on those.
Come on shows.
Yep, absolutely.
Wow. How old were you then? If I look, if anyone's going to cough, it's going to be me or John.
I'm
about
not quite
age.
As old as you.
Not quite. There, he's already. Look, he's on the defence.
A few months behind.
I was a teenager.
You were a teenager. Okay, so still you're playing a wonderful bass. I have to say, and it's a 5-string bass you play.
Yeah.
What made you pick that configuration, if you
There's two reasons. One, you get 5 extra notes, but also in your hand position, you just go up and down the fretboard rather than along. So it's actually easier to play in a way.
Play the 5-string bass. So now I know. I would have taken up the 5-string at the beginning.
And if you break one string, you still got 4
I'm still
left.
Struggling on the 4. but it's a lovely bass, and you played a beautiful sound, I must say. And we're going to go back to the CT Club and listen to a little bit more of that sound with the Rock and Roll All-Star.
Says she's going to mind well when it's cool. If you get back, get on back to Green River. Said, well,
one of my favourite Creedence songs. Now, Mike, do a fine job of that. You vocalise a lot with the band. Did you, up until this band, were you singing?
No, I was always about second or third singer. Always there was a lead singer, and I did a few.
You just did your own little cameos?
Yes, cameos.
That's the word.
Cameo Creedence.
But you're a particular fan of Creedence Clearwater or that sort of music?
Yeah,
suits
yeah, that six, late 60s, 70s, yeah. I really love.
Oh, we all love that music, though. I'll never ever say anything bad about that music.
It still stands
it's got to be the best. It stands up strong, stronger now than ever. We had a young group in here recently called Vivid, a female band, 17-year-olds, 17 and 18. They don't like the new music. They like all ours. And they made me feel so good. I think they were just being kind to an old man. Making an old man feel good. But anyway, I have to say, the way the band works now is great. You've got Chris here now. Now, Chris.
Hello, Shane. How are you?
It's a real pleasure having you here, mate.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here.
You cross over right through from guitar to keyboards in seconds, I may add. He's like, ding, cling, cling. Next thing I know, he's got the guitar and he's back to the keyboard. So you're doing a fine job there.
Oh, thank you.
Your prime instrument, if you like, what did you start out on? Were you a keyboard player?
No, I started out on the guitar. I just self-taught. Yeah, yeah. Beatles started me off, same as Mike.
Yeah, and like all of us. Yeah. And you played in Greece. What were you doing in Greece? Not Zorba's Dance? Or
no,
anything
no,
like
no. That. We played in a, it was sort of a nightclub. It was a big hotel. It had everything. Yeah. It had a nightclub. It had a piano bar.
Tourist type.
All that sort of stuff.
Yeah. More tourist.
Yeah, had cockroaches for Africa, you know, when the lights came on. During the day, we used to go there to rehearse, you know, and it was like Cockroach City. But at night time, with all the lights
dim.
Did
you get friendly with any Greek musicians or anything like that over there?
Yeah, one or two came around. About that time, there was an English guy that invented a guitar tuner, and we'd bought one. We bought it off of Exchange and Mart, and then we went down to London, and it was a great big thing like a shoebox. And we took this out to Greece with us, and it was the first one they'd ever, the Greek musicians.
How did it work? You plug it in?
No, it was like a thing, like a just like the modern ones, but it was typical English, you know, ingenuity, you know, built in a great big box with a big knob, like something like Doctor Who on it. Like this, and you turn this knob to E.
To E and A. And
that's right. And it had like an LED light that went round clockwise if you were sharp, and anti-clockwise if you were flat.
And
it I think it cost about £60, and we took it out to Greece, and these Greek musicians
weighed about £100.
Their eyes, their eyes fell out of their head, and they bought it off us for £200 or something like that. Oh, we'll buy that.
Yeah.
So we sold them that. And
that's an amazing story. Yeah. Now, I believe, apart from that, you're English, aren't you, Chris?
I am, yes.
And whereabouts in England?
I come from Tottenham, and I sort of
Tottenham.
Grew up in
Spurs supporter in the house. Actually, we've only got one Kiwi in the whole room tonight. Isn't it amazing? Mm. It's complete. And then, Mike.
I thought he was Chinese.
They were
Kiwi.
The cruel Poms, and we're all Poms. Anyway, you've got a particular story that I know I can relate to, and you were working as a record rep at the time.
That's right, yeah. And the first run that I did down south, I went to Te Awa Mutu, and I went into this music shop, Martin's Music Shop, and there was this young guy there, and he comes up to me. He was the record buyer. All the shops had youngsters, and he says to me, "Have you got any split end stuff? You got any posters?"
Yeah.
And split ends were sort of, you know, they'd had an album that had been and gone. And I said, "Oh, you're keen." He said, "My brother's in the band." And I said, "Oh, yeah, who's your brother?" He said, "Tim Finn." And I didn't know much of split ends because I'd been overseas.
New band, anyway.
So anyway, the next time I went down there, I found some posters and stuff at work, and I used to go down there every 3 weeks. So 3 weeks later, I went there, and he wasn't there. And the manager of the shop said, "Oh, he's gone off with his brother's band to do the opening act or something." You know, they were disgruntled because he'd gone. So I found out that Split Enz were playing at His Majesty's Theatre in Auckland. So when I got back to Auckland, I got a ticket, and I went along. And Neil did the opening act all on his own. He did about a half
four
an hour.
Split Enz.
He did about seven songs, and about five of them he'd written himself. And he did two Beatles songs. He did Blackbird and Cry Baby Cry.
Oh, cry.
And he played all the instruments. Cry. He played keyboard, mandolin, guitar.
Amazing.
He was absolutely brilliant.
And he was working in the record shop.
He was, yeah.
In Te Awa Mutu?
Yes.
Yeah. Where they came from.
Yes.
And he was running the little record shop. He was the manager of the shop.
Yeah.
So and that was your first meeting with him?
Yeah. So I rung him up and I said, "Neil, I went to that show and you were brilliant." And he said, "Oh, you think so?" And I said, "Yeah, you were better than brilliant." And I said, "I'd like to record your stuff," because I got this little sound-on-sound recorder that I'd bought back from England.
Yeah.
And I borrowed another one from the record company, and he came up and stayed the weekend, and we recorded all the songs that he'd done at this.
So you probably did some of the first recordings
I'm
he ever
sure
ever,
it was,
ever
yeah.
made.
And I took it along every Friday afternoon at the record company. We had a listening session where we'd listen to stuff from overseas and decide what to release and all that. Mm-hmm. So I took this thing. I was so excited. I took this thing along. I'd never heard anything so talented in all my life. Yeah, he was 17. And the manager said, we listened to it, and the manager, he was like long-haired guy into, I'm not going to say who he was. Cause
no, it doesn't matter. No.
And he was into acid rock, you would know him. And he said, it's not very commercial, is it?
Oh, you know,
that was his exact words.
That's my. Yeah. Someone said that to me with St. Paul when I released it. I was so proud of my new record.
Yeah.
I went to this record company guy and I said,
I bet it was the same guy. Record. Was it Pi
Records? And
you know
what he said? It's not very commercial, is it? Yeah. And he said exactly the same. And of course, it was number one for 6 weeks. Yeah. So it would have been the same with Tim's material.
And when I told Neil,
who are these people?
Yeah, when I told Neil, he wasn't a bit phased. He said, "What did they think of it?" Next time I went down there, What did they think of it? And I said, "Well, they weren't, you know, they're talking about maybe getting a studio and doing a demo, but I could tell they weren't really that interested." But he wasn't the least bit phased. It didn't worry him. I met him quite a few times after that and did more recordings when he moved up to Auckland. But that's another story.
And of course, his history speaks it all. I mean, that guy overlooked a great talent. You know, amazing, isn't it? Mm. And it's happened so many times in this business. You just come up against the wrong guy. You've got to keep knocking on the doors. Mm. So anyway, we're going to go back to the Sea Club for some bit of Greek dancing, I think, this time. But back to the CT Club with the Rock and Roll All-Stars. Let's rock our songs off. Vocals there, wants to dance the night away. And they certainly did at the CT Club, didn't they, Chris? Yes. Everyone was on their feet going backwards. And particularly, I noticed a lot of people like line dancing to that. I mean, I'm not into line dancing. I'm not trying to promote it or anything. Sorry. But a lot of people line dance to that song for some reason. Must be the beat or whatever it is, you know. Anyway, Chris, doing a great job of that. Now, there is another member to the band, Chris, and you guys. Rob No. Yep. Now, Rob couldn't be here tonight. I'm guessing he couldn't afford the bus fare or something. Is that right? It's correct. This is a working band in New Zealand. I don't know how tough it is.
He said he'll come next time.
He said he's coming next time. Good on you guys, because we do want you back. But Rob, Rob's a drummer, and he's been with you right through for the last few years.
He's been with us for the last 4 years, I think.
4 years.
Rob, a lot of people will remember Rob. He was the drummer with the High Revving Tongues.
Of course. And I'm so looking forward to having him.
Yeah. And he was like, he had a long break away. Mm. And he's only been back drumming about 10 years, I think.
Which is a long time to be back. And, but he was the drummer for the High Revving Tongues.
Yeah.
And we all know Trop of Capricorn. And we had
Red and Tears.
I was going to say their bass player, but he does play bass now. Chris Parfitt, the lead singer. He was in one of our early shows with Roger Skinner.
Yep.
He was playing bass for him. But they're all still out there working really hard. And it's good to see you guys still out there working hard. Mm. And of course,
we're not working
hard,
we're playing hard.
Playing hard, that's
what I mean. We're not working, we're playing.
Never stop playing hard. Now, in particular, there's one favourite song that you guys perform that I just love, and it's a song called Wagon Wheel. Do you mind if we just go down to the CT Club and see just a little clip of that? It's a wonderful song. Yeah. Well done, well performed. Enjoy.
Headed down south through the land of the pines, thumbing my way up to North Carolina, staring up the road, pray to God I see headlights. I made it down the coast in 17 hours, picking me a bouquet of dogwood flowers, and I'm hoping for Riley.
Listen to that little bit of Wagon Wheel. It's a great song, I'm sure you'll agree. And Rock and Roll All Stars, it's been such a pleasure having you here this evening. And before we go, though, everybody, if you want to go and check these guys out, go and see them play live. There is a website. It's right under my nose. Easy to see. Now, just check that out. Look it up. And it's got all their gigs, the profiles, everything, biography, and all the stories that I couldn't tell you about them tonight. It's all online. Okay, guys, Rock and Roll All Stars, thank you so much, John.
Thank you, Shane.
And thank you to Mike, and thank you, Chris. Shane. And of course, thank Rob for us from the High Revving Tongues and now the Rock and Roll All Stars. We'll see you next week with more great live New Zealand music. Good night.